Penguin Random House Audio presents Post-Corona, From Crisis to Opportunity. This is the author, Scott Galloway. Introduction. We're taught time is a reliable, relentless force. The sun's progress across the sky and our seasonal orbit around the sun establish an immortal, uniform rhythm. However, our perception of time is not constant. As we age, our frame of reference, the past, expands, and the years move faster. This morning, I kissed my son goodbye before his first day of kindergarten. This afternoon, he came home from the fifth grade. It's the opposite for him. His school believes that same fifth grade should be a safe place to fail. His first C's and D's arrest time frequently. What we experience is change, not time. Aristotle observed that time does not exist without change because what we call time is simply our measurement of the difference between before and after. Hence, our daily experience of time dragging or flying by. Time is malleable, paced by change. And the smallest thing can create unprecedented change, even something as small as a virus. In early March of 2020, we were living in the before. The novel coronavirus was in the news, but just. Outside China, there was little to suggest a global crisis was unfolding. 41 people had died in northern Italy, but in the rest of Europe, life was unchanged. The United States reported its first death on March 1st, but the big news was Mayor Pete suspended his campaign for the presidency. There were no closures, no masks, and most people wouldn't have recognized Dr. Anthony Fauci. By the end of the month, we were in the after. The world shut down, hundreds of thousands of people tested positive for the virus, including Tom Hanks, Placido Domingo, Boris Johnson, and dozens of sailors on a U.S. aircraft carrier in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. A virus 1/400th the width of a human hair grabbed a sphere weighing 13 billion trillion tons and set it spinning 10 times faster. Yet even as time changed sped up, our lives felt static. Like my son holding his first bad report card, we lost our capacity to imagine anything beyond the present moment. No before or after, just Zoom calls, takeout, and Netflix. We checked case counts and deaths versus game scores and movie times. The hit movie of summer was Palm Springs, a story of two people living the same day over and over again. Having experienced 50-odd trips around the sun, I know we are wrong about the persistence of this moment. I try to convince myself what I tell my boys. This too shall pass. This book is an attempt to look beyond our unprecedented present and predict the future by creating it, catalyzing a dialogue that crafts better solutions. When the only astronomical object known to harbor life reverts to its regular rate of rotation, what will be different about business, education, and our country? Will it be more humane and prosperous, or will people prefer it to just stop spinning? What can we do to shape the after? I'm an entrepreneur and a business school professor, so I view things through the lens of business. That's the core of this book, how the pandemic will reshape the business environment. I examine how the pandemic has favored big companies and big tech most of all. A healthy portion of this book is a pandemic-era update to my first book, The Four, revisiting Amazon, Apple, Facebook, and Google. I also look at the disruption opportunities outside the sectors dominated by The Four and some of the firms poised to prosper. Business doesn't operate in a vacuum, so I connect the business story to our broader societal story. I've devoted an entire chapter to higher education, as I believe it's on the cusp of transformative change. I write about the ways in which the pandemic has revealed and accelerated broader trends in our culture and politics, why I believe that a generation of changes undertaken in the name of capitalism have undermined the capitalist system, and what we can do about it. This has been a worldwide crisis, and while my examples and analysis are rooted in a U.S. experience, I hope these insights will hold value for readers in other countries. I begin with two theses. First, the pandemic's most enduring impact will be as an accelerant. While it will initiate some changes and alter the direction of some trends, the pandemic's primary effect has been to accelerate dynamics already present in society. Second, in any crisis, there is opportunity. The greater and more disruptive the crisis, the greater the opportunities. However, my optimism on the second point is tempered by the first. Many of the trends the pandemic accelerates are negative and weaken our capacity to recover and thrive in a post-corona world. The Great Acceleration. There's a saying attributed to Lenin: nothing can happen for decades, and then decades can happen in weeks. It wasn't Lenin, but Scottish MP George Galloway. Great name. Galloway was paraphrasing, with typical Scottish brevity, something much more roundabout and obtuse that Lenin said in 1918, after the radical changes wrought by his revolution. This theme, decades and weeks, is playing out in most sectors and facets of life. E-commerce began taking root in 2000. Since then, e-commerce's share of retail has grown approximately 1% every year. At the beginning of 2020, approximately 16% of retail was transacted via digital channels. 8 weeks after the pandemic reached the U.S., March to mid-April, that number leapt to 27%, and it's not going back. We registered a decade of e-commerce growth in 8 weeks. Here we have a chart of online sales over the last 11 years. From 2009 to 2019, e-commerce grew about 1% a year, from 5.6% to 16%. Then in Q1 of 2020, when the pandemic hit, online sales grew 11% to 27% of total sales in 8 weeks. That's 11 years of growth in 8 weeks. Take any trend, social, business, or personal, and fast forward 10 years. Even if your firm isn't there yet, consumer behavior and the market now rests on the 2030 point on the trend line, positive or negative. If your firm had a weak balance sheet, it's now untenable. If you're in essential retail, your goods are more essential than ever. If you're in discretionary retail, you are more discretionary than ever. In your personal life, if you were fighting with your partner, your arguments are worse. Good relationships now have another decade of history and goodwill. For decades, companies invested millions of dollars in equipment for virtual meetings, hoping to diminish distance. Universities begrudgingly adopted tech tools, including Blackboard in the early 90s, to sort of keep pace with the outside world. Communications companies ran numerous ads featuring virtual family dinners, doctors seeing patients from across the country, and students learning from the world's great teachers without leaving their hometown. And for decades, not much happened. Multi-million-dollar video conference systems didn't work, and faculty resisted any tech more complex than dry erase or PowerPoint. FaceTime and Skype made inroads in our personal communications, but didn't reach critical mass. Then in weeks, our lives moved online and business went remote. Every business meeting went virtual, every teacher became an online educator, and social gatherings moved to a screen. In the markets, investors calibrated the value of disruptive companies based not on the next weeks or years, but on assumptions of the firm's position in 2030. It took Apple 42 years to reach $1 trillion in value and 20 weeks to accelerate from $1 trillion to $2 trillion. March to August 2020. In those same weeks, Tesla became not only the most valuable car company in the world, but more valuable than Toyota, Volkswagen, Daimler, and Honda combined. Here we have a chart showing Tesla's market capitalization has increased threefold from March until the end of August 2020, while the other automakers increased at most 10%. For decades, big city mayors and planning officials have been calling for more bike lanes, pedestrian access, and fewer cars. And for decades, traffic, air pollution, and accidents congested our streets and skies. Then in weeks, cyclists took over the road, outdoor dining tables sprouted, and skies cleared. Negative trends may have accelerated at a greater rate. For decades, economists have been warning that economic inequality was deepening, while economic mobility was declining. An economy with uncomfortable underlying trends has morphed to a dystopia. 40% of Americans, we were told, would have trouble covering a $400 emergency expense. But an unprecedented 11-year economic expansion meant the tide never went out. Then in the first 3 months of the COVID-19 recession, we lost more employment, 13%, than we lost in the 2 years of the Great Recession, 5%. Half of U.S. households have had at least one person lose a job or take a pay cut because of the outbreak. Households with income below...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.